We're going to start a new series today called The Holy Spirit That I Never Knew. The Holy Spirit That I Never Knew. For you country folk, The Holy Spirit I Never Knew. You can leave that out. But The Holy Spirit That I Never Knew. And I want to be honest with you this morning. And I want you to be honest with me. How many of you have questions about the Holy Spirit? How he works, who is he, what does he do, what's real, what's false? Can I see those show of hands again if you have questions about the Holy Spirit? As I was preparing this yesterday, the Lord dealt with me, and I contacted Pastor Andy. So on all of our screens that we have up throughout this series, you will have a website at the bottom. It says holyspirit@mfctoday.org. We feel the Holy Spirit is so important. He has his own web address on our website. They just created it yesterday, actually. You can go to our website, click on the link. You can also go on your app, on the phone, on your phone app. You can click on the link there, and it'll take you. You can ask whatever question. The purpose in that is hopefully we can address some of the questions you may have throughout this series. I want to give you the topics if I could. I don't normally do this. Today we're going to cover the Holy Spirit, who he is. Next Sunday, is he a person? The third Sunday, I'm not sure if I'll go with, is he temporary or what is his DNA? The fourth week, does he unify? Number five is the prelude to Pentecost. But on the alternate services, the Sunday nights and the Wednesday nights that I preach, I want to cover, is he charismatic? Is he Pentecostal? Does he baptize? Or does he speak in tongues? So I'll cover that on the Wednesday nights and Sunday nights when I preach, but I hope you're excited about the new series that we're starting. We have a special treat for you. The Townsman Quartet will be here with Pastor Mitchell Birch tonight, so please press out for that. Are you ready to get into the Holy Spirit That I Never Knew? Who is he? The Holy Spirit. Who is he? In three chapters in John 14, 15, and 16, Jesus is having a conversation with his disciples. He's having a conversation, and it's very deep in its context, and many theologians believe that this conversation in these three chapters took place in the last 12 hours of the life of Jesus. And he's having this conversation with his disciples, and the context is this: I'm going away, but don't be troubled. I'm sending someone in my place. And Jesus is having this heavy conversation when he has walked with these disciples. And he said, I'm going away, and it's to your advantage that I go. He said, you will be better. You'll be stronger. You'll be better equipped that I go. And I send another one in my place. And what Jesus is really doing, he is introducing them to the Holy Spirit. In John 14, 16, and 17, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper. Notice that word helper. And he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Notice the words that I asked them to underline in this text. Notice the words, he and him. The Bible never, never refers to the Holy Spirit as it. Always he or him. Because the Holy Spirit is not an it. You cannot have a personal relationship with an it. You can only have a personal relationship with people or a person. So understand the Holy Spirit is a person that we can have a personal, intimate relationship with. Amen? John 14, 25 and 26. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you, but the Helper, there's that word again, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all the things that I said to you. I love that he says that the Holy Spirit will bring all things to your remembrance that I've said to you. John 15, 26. But when the Helper, make mention that word Helper. But when the Helper comes, whom I send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will testify of me. John 16:7 Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. Now, what Jesus is saying here, what I'm about to tell you, is going to be hard for you to receive and believe. Jesus said, but I'm telling you the truth. He said, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I go away, the Helper will come to you, but if I depart, I will send him to you. Last one, John 16:12-13 I still have many things to say to you. Jesus is saying there's still many things I want you to know and many things that needs to be revealed. He said, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you in all truth. He will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak and he will tell you things to come. Four times in these scriptures that I just read to you, we find the word or term, name, helper. The word helper in the Greek is parakletos. Our English word for this is paraclete. You heard of that. But parakletos, it means helper, intercessor, counselor, advocate, or I'm sorry, consoler or comforter. It's two words. Para means alongside. Kletos means to come. It means to walk, to come alongside. Jesus is saying, I'm sending a helper to come alongside of you, to help you, to strengthen you, to anoint you, to lift you, to carry you, to instruct you, to help you. He's saying, I'm not going to leave you, but I'm going to send one in my place that can do what I can't do. I know that's hard for us to understand, but just walk with me a little bit. The old King James translation calls him comforter. Instead of helper, it calls him comforter. Many of us have what we call a comforter in our house. Can anybody raise your hand and say, yes, amen, I have a comforter in my house. It's on your bed. We used to just have bedspreads. When my wife and I, we got married, we had a bedspread. It was real thin. It was spread real thin. It was probably a hand-me-down. But now we have a comforter. And what I've realized about comforters is that they are more for looks than use. Many times on a comforter, you'll not use it, but you'll peel it back and just leave it at the foot of the bed. Men, don't amen right there. I'm realizing there's several things around the house that are there to bring us comfort that is more for looks than it is use. Anybody have those things in your house? They're just there to look good and bring you comfort and welcome guests. I mean, we have plates on our dinner table that are out all the time. But come dinner time, they're put up and we use the old ones in the cabinet because the other ones are just for looks, not for napkins. I'm walking real lightly. I remember being at the beach one time. Don't get mad at me, honey. I remember being at the beach one time. And she's decorating the dining room. I'm thinking, this dining room is going to be so nice. I can't wait. We are actually buying napkin holders. I'm thinking, this is serious. We're buying napkin holders. We're moving up, brother. We're just like the Jeffersons. We're moving up. We've got napkin holders and napkins to go inside. But I realize they're not for me. But you can come to the house and you can use them. But bless God, when I eat up in the cabinet, get your plate, and the napkins are paper. More for looks than use. Anybody have those things in your house? You first walk in our bathroom. You walk through the door and you see the wall on the other end, and there is a beautiful towel rack on that wall, and it has turquoise colored towels, brown colored towels. They're beautiful towels. They're fat towels, plump towels, thick towels, lush towels. And I found out that you can use them, but I can't. their guest towels or their for looks towels. It's more for looks than it is for use. I found out early on, they're not to dry off with. What were you thinking? You're stand there, you're wet, you're naked, there's a towel. I don't know, where's a roll of paper towels? I don't know what I was thinking. Oh, you've been there, haven't you, Chris? More for looks than it is for use. And what I'm finding out is how many of us have a comforter that is more for looks than he is for use. Oh, he looks good, but I don't use him. And I want you to understand, he is not for looks, but the comforter, the helper, your guide, he is for use. He is the one that empowers us to walk the walk that God has called us to walk. Outside of him, we cannot do it. But we must have the helper, the paracletos, to come alongside us, strengthen us and guide us and help us. Can somebody say amen? Who is he? Number one, he is my helper. He's my helper. Jesus is telling his disciples, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage. It's better for you if I go away than for me to stay. Church, I want you to understand, the church is better now with the Holy Spirit present than it was when Jesus was walking the earth, healing the sick and raising the dead. Why? Because now the Holy Spirit has empowered every believer to do what Jesus did. Now, many are not operating in that because we fouled up the work of the Holy Spirit, but the original purpose of the Holy Spirit was sent to empower the believer to do exactly and greater works, Jesus said, than he did, because he goes to the Father. What he intends for us to do is to do exactly what Jesus did. Oh, that's good stuff. It's the Holy Spirit that enables us to live a Christian life. Outside of it, I've been preaching on the fruit of the Spirit. And there is no way that we can operate or possess the fruit of the Spirit outside of the Holy Spirit. It's the only way we can live the Christian life is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Our natural mind cannot understand the things of God, but the Spirit reveals them to us. The first service, we were talking about how the Holy Spirit helped Pastor Terry in the prayer room to know what to pray. And he's down there praying. He said, the only thing I know that if Jesus be lifted up, he'll draw all people to himself. And we get into worship, and that's a second song. J.D. and Nicole didn't know what was on Pastor Terry's heart, what the Holy Spirit put there. But what I want you to understand, God witnessed, God helped Pastor Terry to know and to pray. But what I want you to understand, J.D. and Nicole, that set list was not, it wasn't just spare of the moment put together. It was planned. And many people have problem with a plan. If it isn't spontaneous, it isn't of the Holy Spirit. Are you saying that the Holy Spirit is so small that he can't speak to a man of God in a secret place and give him 10 days before what set list we're supposed to pray to witness to another man of God? My God is not that small. There must be room for spontaneity. We saw that. We saw that in that third song. When the song was finished, Holy Spirit said, I'm not finished. Landed on the coal, and it went out in spontaneous worship. That's messing some of your theology up right now. How do you know what you're going to be preaching on, Holy Spirit? Talk to me about it. But he's so big, he has room to change it if he wants to get in the middle of it. That is good. I remember, listen, the Holy Spirit enables us to see. He enables us to know. He enables us to understand. I remember when I was still in Enterprise, pastoring up in Enterprise, and Pastor Joey McCutcheon was there as our worship leader, and his mom, Judy McCutcheon, come up for a service there to Enterprise, and I preached, and after service, she come up, and she said, man, Pastor, the Lord really helped you. And I'd never heard that term before, and I realize that's more of a Maranatha type term or that terminology than anywhere else. I have pastor friends come in and say, I heard this term, Jesus helped me. What does that mean? When she came up to me, she said, man, the Lord really helped you. I thought, oh my goodness, was it that bad? Was the struggle that visible on the inside of me to where you could tell that Jesus had to help me? Was I that lacking that you could see Jesus intervene? Basically, yes, but I don't mean it as a cut down. I mean it as a compliment, because you got out of the way and allowed the Holy Spirit. So I've come to desire and say, Jesus, I don't know what to say. I don't know how to do it. Would you please just help me? And what she was saying, I saw you get out of the way, and I watched God come through. Vessels need to yield to the ministering of the Holy Spirit and let Him have His way. Somebody give God praise this morning. There's three specific ways that the Holy Spirit helps us. Direct your attention to John 16, verses 8 through 11. John 16, 8 through 11. And when He comes, He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they do not believe me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. Verse 8. And when He comes, He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Another word for convict in the Greek is convince. To be convinced of a truth. The Holy Spirit has come to convict. To convict us of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. And the church looks at this as a negative. Jesus is just trying to get me. Jesus just trying to tell me how bad I am. That is a lie from the pits of hell. That is not what conviction is about. He said that He convicts the world of sin, righteousness, and of judgment. He has come to convict us of truth. Oh, just bear with me. Why? Listen, verse 9, it says, He convicts of sin because they do not believe in me. The Holy Spirit convicts us of sin because we don't understand that we're a sinner. And if we don't understand we're a sinner, how can we understand we need a Savior? The only way we can know that we need a Savior is to first be convinced or convicted of being a sinner. We're all sinners and falling short of the glory of God, every one of us. So this is the way that the Holy Spirit convicts us, to let us know we really need a Savior. And the only way we can be convinced of that is by the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12:3, no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. It is only when the Holy Spirit convicts us that we then realize we need a Savior. Can somebody say amen? The Holy Spirit convinces or reveals to us the need to be saved. Many make a decision based on what they're going through instead of who they really need. Wow. I see it many times in church services that someone's going through something and they want Jesus to make it better. So they come to an altar in hopes that Jesus will make it better. And if He makes it better, I'll go back out and I'll do whatever the heck I want to do. And we're missing the genuine need of a Savior. Is it clear? We know when our body is broken. We know when our marriage is a mess. We know when our finances are in terrible shape. We know what's causing us pain. But do we know the genuine need in our life? I know when I'm in pain. I know when I hurt. I know that my finances need help. I know that my marriage needs help. But do I know that I first need a Savior before He can ever address those other things? See, we just want Jesus to make us feel better. He's not into making us feel better. He wants to save our soul permanently. Until we are convinced that we need a Savior, we're just going to go through motions. I see it. I'm sad to report it, but I see it. I see people in and out. And the only time we see them is when they're going through. And I know when there's a calm in their life because they're not here. That is not salvation. I'm sorry, that's just going through motions. Jesus is after your heart. He's after a relationship with you. That's what the Holy Spirit has come to convict us of, to know that we need a Savior. I remember in July of 1990, when my wife and I, when we made the decision, we went to an altar and we gave our hearts to Jesus Christ together in July of 1990. And do you know what I remember most about that night? Is the conviction I felt on the inside of me of knowing that I was lost and on my way to hell unless something happened. That's what I remember most. And if you've truly been saved, you know what I'm talking about. And I must be honest with you, I would not take anything for that conviction. Even to this day, when I do something that isn't pleasing to God, I wouldn't trade that conviction for anything, because that conviction is what keeps me right there in the palm. Oh. Verse 10, he convicts of righteousness because I go to the Father and you'll see me no more. This is righteousness, not right living. It's not talking about right living. No, he convicts us of right living, but that's not what that's addressing here. Righteousness is right standing with God. He convicts or convinces us that Jesus has paid our sin debt in full. And in that, by that, we accept Jesus as our Savior. And that puts us right in the right standing with God. That we now, when we are convicted by the Holy Spirit and we make things right with God, we now become sons and daughters of God. And then we are in right standing with Him. We find our identity in Him. We know who we are in Him. Outside of Him, we will never have true understanding who we are. We see people running around all over the place trying to figure out who they are. We've even made jokes about it. But frankly, it's not a laughing matter. Because really what this is, these are lost sons and daughters living in darkness that was created to live in light. And God's just trying to extract them from the world and give them His identity so they truly know who He is. He convicts us of righteousness, of right living. There's times that I'll see people out in the lobby or out at stores or different places at the mall, and I'll say, hey, how you doing? Well, better than I deserve. First of all, stand up straight and you'll feel better. Put a smile on your face and I'll feel better. Better than I deserve. Well, you know what? Yeah, that can be said true of all of us, because if we got what we deserved, we'd already be in hell right now. But it isn't about what we deserve. It's about God's goodness, and it's about the believer knowing he has God's goodness and operating in God's goodness. It isn't about what I deserve. It's about knowing that I am a son, a joint heir with Jesus Christ, and His Holy Spirit dwells on the inside of me. Therefore, I have all the power of the Godhead. I have resurrection flowing through my veins. I have the Spirit of God living alive in this, on the inside of me. Number three, he convicts us of judgment. Because the ruler of this world is judged. Now, at the time of this scripture, the ruler of the world was Satan. But in John 12:31, it says, now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. In John 14:30, I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming and he has nothing in me. Now listen. The Holy Spirit convicts or convinces us that Satan was the ruler of this world, but he now has been judged and cast out, and Jesus has now taken back the keys or the deed. Can somebody say amen? The Holy Spirit wants us to know our authority in this earth and walk in it. The kingdom awaits God's children, sons and daughters, to understand who they are in Him and operate in that authority. When He corrects me, listen, when He corrects me when I'm wrong, He's convincing me that I'm forgiven when I give way to Him and I'm righteous by the grace of God. Many people have this concept that when we read about conviction of the Holy Spirit, is it we get this concept that He's just trying to point out that I'm bad and that He's going to get me and He's going to send me to hell for having fun. Let's just be honest. Many times we talk about conviction, that's what it is, but that's not what it's stating in this verse. He helps us by understanding through conviction, one, that I need a Savior, two, that I can be in right standing with God, and three, I have authority over all the power of the enemy. Can somebody put your hands together and thank the Lord this morning and be joyful? Number two, and I only have 2 points, so you're almost there. Number two, who is He? He is my friend. The Holy Spirit is my friend. Just tell your neighbor, the Holy Spirit is my friend. He's my friend, and He's not weird. That just eliminated about 50% of all the questions right there that we're going to get. He's my friend, and my friend, the Holy Spirit, He is not weird. Now, I know what you've seen and heard. And I'm just going to keep my hands in my pocket. We've seen and heard people talk about Jesus, talk about the Holy Spirit, and they acted weird. Don't look around. And can I tell you, they'd be weird without the Holy Spirit. Just laugh under your breath. It isn't the Holy Spirit that made them weird. They had a jump start on the Holy Spirit. They were weird before that. I know it is. There's a new study that 1 in 3 people are weird. Look to the left. Look to the right. If neither one of them look weird. Okay, I'm just joking. It isn't 1 in 3, it's 1 in 2. Okay, we've had fun, listen to me. You can be normal and believe in the person and the power of the Holy Spirit. Please hear my heart, you don't have to be spooky or goofy or weird. That is not a prerequisite. Just be you and the Holy Spirit. But don't give Him a bad rap. You can be normal and filled with the person and the power of the Holy Spirit. Now listen to me, I'm almost to close. The Holy Spirit is the one who empowers us to win the whole world to Jesus Christ. It's the Holy Spirit that He empowers me, Acts 1:8. He empowers me to be witnesses. To all the earth. It's only by Him that I can shine with Jesus Christ. If there's anything good in me, it's because He's living in me. He is the one that empowers us to win the world to Jesus Christ. And Satan knows it. Now just bear with me. So Satan does his best to make the church afraid of the Holy Spirit. This is good stuff if you just listen. So Satan twists, perverts what he can to make believers in Jesus Christ afraid of the Holy Spirit. Satan looked at the first church on the day of Pentecost when the power was poured out. And he saw the true power of the Holy Spirit when 3,000 souls were saved and the sick was healed and they turned the world upside down. I believe Acts 6 says, then these men turned the world upside down. And Satan witnessed this power. So then when he saw this same power beginning to stir in the 1900s and the 2000s, he said, I've got to mess this thing up. And he shifted all the focus to one gift and made much of the church afraid of the Holy Spirit, and he's done a good job of it. And can I tell you, there is not just one gift. However, that one gift is still in operation. No gifts are without being in operation. They're all still in operation. We'll cover them sometime later. But the enemy has shifted much of it to one gift. And can I just be honest? People acting kooky and goofy and freaky and weird has made much of God's church afraid of the Holy Spirit. When we were created to be indwelled, empowered by what we're actually afraid of. My Lord. God wants His church to operate in that power again. It is only when we embrace who He is. My helper. My friend. It's only when we embrace who He is that we can function in that power. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. They're not divided, they are unified. They are one. That is the Holy Trinity. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. You cannot receive one and reject the other. Because if you reject one, you reject all. Same is true that if we receive one, we should receive all. I pray this is making sense to you this morning. Hallelujah. Let me wrap this up, JD and Nicole. Three times, listen, the church has listened to too many lies of the enemy and not listened to the friend of the Holy Spirit. Three times in Scripture I read to you this morning that Jesus calls Him, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth. The only way we can really know what is true is for it to be revealed by and through the Holy Spirit. It's the only way that real genuine truth can be revealed to us. You want to know what is the truth? Get alone with Him and ask Him. You want to know the genuine motives of someone? Get alone and ask Him to reveal the truth to you. And He will. Yes, sir. Who you been listening to? Who have you been listening to? I was preparing this message. I was thinking back about how all the times that the Holy Spirit had helped me through the past 26 years of being a son. You know, all I ever wanted to be was a son. It's all I ever wanted to be was a son. And I can tell you that He's been good to me. He tells me in John 14:18, He said, I'll not leave you as an orphan, but I'll come to you. And I can say that's true of my friend. Through the good times and the rough times, He's never left me. Even when everyone else walked away from me and I stood all by myself, He was right there with me the entire time. Through the rich times and the lean times, my friend took every step of the road with me. But I remember when I was getting ready to make the hardest decision of my life, I reflected back yesterday in preparing this message that when I was 42 years old, Pastor Wright asked me to come be the associate pastor here at Maranatha. And to be honest with you, it was the hardest decision of my life up till that time. We were part of a healthy, growing ministry and enterprise. had all the comfort that flesh could stand, not to be confused with the comfort of God. I had all the comfort of man that I could stand. I had a brand new home that I drew the blueprints up on, lived on 3 acres. I even had a Kubota diesel four-wheel drive tractor to mow my grass with. Not that I miss it, but I do. Had a good salary, pastored a great church full of great people. And I loved them and they loved me. And I remember being asked to come to be an associate pastor here, and it was the hardest decision of my life. And I remember I sought counsel. I sought godly counsel. I sought counsel of some of my closest pastoral friends. Not just friends, Pastor Jay, but pastors that I loved and I believed in. And I said, what do you think? Do you think I should make this move? And every one of my friends said, I wouldn't do it if I were you. I believe it's a trap. And I remember being so low that day. And I remember my wife came home and I was moping around the house and she said, what's wrong? And I said, honey, I said, I think I'm going to call Pastor Wright tomorrow and tell him that I just can't do it. She looked at me and she said, who have you been listening to? Hallelujah. Who has the church been listening to? People dressed up looking the part. But do we have calluses on our knees to show that we've been in His presence, seeking after the heart of God? Do we have a place that we can run to and say, Daddy, I don't know. I need my friend. I need my friend to show me. I can't know unless you show me. So the next morning, I called my friend. I said, God, what is your will for my life? Should I stay or should I go? He spoke two things to me. If not now, when? Number two, do you want my peace or do you want man's comfort? It's all I needed. I'd heard from my friend, but it went against every pastoral friend that I had. Who did I believe? We need to be at a place to where we stop relying on people around us. And we get in contact with our friend. And we move based on what our friend said, not on what those around us said. Stand your feet this morning. So this morning, what's He saying to you? Take a moment right where you are and just ask the Holy Spirit, what are you saying to me through this word today? What are you speaking to me about? And let Him speak. And as he speaks, you come to the altar. You bring it to Him. You struggling today? Bring it to Him. Did He convict you that you need a Savior today? Come to Him. Did He convict you and say that you are mine, you're in right standing with me? Come and thank Him today. Did He solidify who He was in being the supreme ruler? Then come and give Him praise today. Whatever it is, you come. You have a loved one that's struggling? Bring that to Him. But as He speaks to you this morning, you come. Maybe you could come and just give Him worship. Just come, get in His presence, and just worship Him. If you have a tough decision you need to make, come and make contact with Him. Whatever your need is, you come now, as J.D. and Nicole say. Spouses, if they would maybe just come and pray with some people around the altar, if there's altar workers, prayer warriors, that would just come and just lift up a brother or a sister that may be going through something you don't even realize. But could you just come and maybe intercede with them as they sing?
When you speak, when you move, Lord, when you do what only you can do, it changes us. Changes what we seek, what we seek. When you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, changes.
Thank you, Jesus. Let me say as we close this morning that if you are going to raise children, if you are going to be married in life, if you have a desire to make accurate, correct decisions, you need the Holy Spirit in your life. I don't see it as an option, because our desires and our flesh will lead us down the wrong path. But He, the Spirit of truth, will lead us in all truth. And there's been times that the Holy Spirit has revealed things to parents about their children that they couldn't even believe their children was in. But He's given them the grace and the strength to sustain them in that and guide them into a good, perfect plan. Many times we go through stuff. That is not the stopping point, nor is it the end. It's just the place where our helper comes alongside and strengthens us and equips us to get through what we thought would kill us, but instead brought us great revelation of who He is. So we need Him this morning, individually and corporately. By God's grace, I will not minimize the work or leadership of the Holy Spirit. He is the one that led me here, and He's my only direction. The only way I know which way to go is by Him and through Him. And He is the one that leads us in all truth. Father, we thank You for who You are. We thank You for Your love that You have directed toward us, God. And Father, we thank You for the helper, our friend of the Holy Spirit. And we give praise, glory, and adoration unto You. We thank You for it, and we ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. May the Lord bless you. We'll see you tonight. Thank you for being here this morning. Praise the Lord. Can you thank God for Chris, who accepted the Lord this morning? Come on. Hallelujah.